cold and winter air and mountain rain combining. This icy force, both foul and fair, has a frozen harbor lining. So cut through the heart, cold and clear, strike for love and strike for fear.
Hey there, welcome to Table to Stage. I'm Jordan Werma, and this is my podcast, my continuing mission to explore creativity and to speak with artists and creators from all areas of life. Today's creator is Bill Covitz. He's the owner and artist behind Ice Matters. Bill is an ice carver. He makes art with power tools and gigantic blocks of ice with incredible detail and in temperatures that, quite frankly, are just not acceptable. But rather than spend any more time trying to warm you up for this conversation, let's jump right in. Here's ice carver Bill Covitz. So are you originally from Connecticut?
I was born on Long Island and grew up in Richfield,
okay,
just south of Danbury.
Yeah.
So I went to kindergarten there and all through high school, so I spent majority of my young life there.
Where did you go after high school?
To the Culinary Institute of America in Hyde Park, New York.
Okay. Was that something you've been planning for a long time, to go to culinary school?
All through high school and stuff, my first job was at a deli. I was making sausage patties and hamburgers and working the counter. And then I went into a small restaurant in town, was a dishwasher and prep cook and then line cook. And
She went all the stages of the restaurant life there, huh?
learned it all there.
Yeah. Yeah. So how long did you work in the restaurant world?
Question. I graduated in 88 and I went into ice carving in 96. So I guess I went into, I probably left my last job in 97.
Okay.
Around there. It's about 2.5 years in Boston carving ice before I moved back to Connecticut.
Okay. You were carving ice in Boston while still working in restaurants?
Correct.
All right. Yeah. So what was it about ice carving that made you consider leaving? Because, I mean, you were a French chef, right? And, I mean, to me, who doesn't know much about the culinary world, that sounds like a very elite thing.
It was. I mean, that was my passion. Food was my passion. And I felt that the French, just the way they created the sauces and just the basic foundation of cooking came from them.
Yeah.
I always worked in French restaurants after that. So I was very passionate about it. And, you know, I love to cook not only for the food and the pleasure of eating and the pleasure of the plate presentation, but I love to travel.
Yeah.
I love to see new things. And I was never good at staying in one place. So I would work about 2 years at an individual place and then move on. I graduated culinary school. I wanted to ski. You know,
okay.
I was young. I wanted to be in the mountains. I wanted to ski. So I moved to Colorado.
Okay.
And was working in Beaver Creek at Cordillera Lodge. It's a beautiful French European resort.
Yeah.
Was there for about two and a half years skiing and mountain biking. And then I wanted to get to the beach and we moved to LA and worked in LA. And
So
did a lot of traveling, cooking. And in that hospitality field, you have that opportunity.
Yeah.
You know, you can get up and go. You always find a job, especially if you work well and, you know, and you're good at what you do. You could do that. And that made it easy for me to go where I wanted to.
So were you like an executive chef, or what was the position that you held when you left?
I always consider myself the best executive sous chef.
Okay.
The sous chef is first in command under the chef.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm a worker, you know, I love to work. The chef sits in his office a lot, writes menus and, you know, it's not, I'd like to be on the front. I'd like to be with the brigade, as we called it, in the kitchen.
Yeah, so working with your hands is something that's always been
I'm a hands-on. I'm not an office person.
Okay.
I have to be moving all the time, and I really enjoy it. And I have been a chef. I was a chef up in Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
But it takes away, I think, from the experience of it.
Yeah. When you considered leaving the kitchen, what was it about carving that was appealing to you? Had you been doing some level of that as a chef, or was it a new experience that you wanted to pursue?
I first got my taste of the Culinary Institute in Garmage class. It's the cold kitchen.
Okay.
Liked it. Never thought I would do it as a profession. And when I moved up to Vermont and Stowe, I worked at Trapp Family Lodge at one of the places, and I was the buffet chef, and not like your normal buffet. It was a grand buffet. I would prepare all week.
Okay.
I would make pâtés, terrines, you know, do a lot of chauffeur work. I mean, high-end, really nice stuff, but I would do an ice carving as well.
Okay.
That's when I was doing it every week. And I thought I was pretty good. I got a lot of good compliments on it. And looking back, they were pretty bad. they needed a lot of work. But, you know, I felt just it's in the hospitality field. It's something about it, you know, clicked with me.
Yeah.
And when I was up there, a former chef from New York that I was working with while I was going to culinary school, the gentleman who taught me my true passion for food and caring about ingredients and freshness and just everything, he asked me to come to Newport, Rhode Island and help him open up a French restaurant.
Oh, okay.
That he was opening. And
I've been to Newport a couple times and have been blown away by the restaurants that I've been able to eat at. So if you're getting an invitation to cook at a restaurant in Newport, I mean, that's got to be a pretty satisfying invitation to get as a chef.
It is, and I owe a lot to the chef. It transferred to my ice carving. It transferred to my life, and what he taught me are the foundations of ethic and, you know, how you work and your passion. And you have all that, you put it all together, you're going to go places, you know. And it's tough. It's a lot of work, but he instilled all of that in me. When he called me and asked for help, and, of course, I knew he didn't have a lot of money. And, you know, you're opening a place, but he's gambling, and I figured I owed it to him. And so I went down there. Again, my normal two and a half years and, Newport at the time in the winter, there wasn't a lot to do.
Right. Seasonal town.
Exactly. It's grown a lot now and there's, you know, they carry a lot over and now with how warm it is and, you know, it's, there's a lot more to do there, but didn't have anything to do. And again, I could have sat around, I could have just enjoyed the winters, but I approached a local ice house and I asked them if I could open up an ice carving business.
Oh, wow.
I just thought it would keep me busy. There's some hotels and, you know, there's a bunch of stuff going on there. And I thought, if I made some side money and got to play a bit, it would be good. And they were very nice and accepted, you know, me to do that. And I was probably there about a month, did a few carvings here and there. But then they referred me to a gentleman in Boston.
Okay.
Somebody they were associated with, a gentleman who owned his own ice carving company and was a master ice carver. I had never heard of a master ice carver. Right. Somebody's doing this full time. And I'm like, you got to get me in there. And so I went up there to meet him and walked into his studio and was just completely awestruck. I had no idea how far you could push ice, what you could do with ice. And I couldn't believe it. I was really amazed. And so I immediately felt I don't deserve to have a business. and I shouldn't be doing a business. And I asked him if I could work part-time for him.
Kind of like an apprenticeship?
Exactly. You know, because I had a job. I had to work the weekends in the winter, you know, where the restaurant was still open. But I offered to come up for Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And I offered to work for free. And who wouldn't do
that? Nobody turns down free labor.
Nobody does, you know, and unfortunately, and I don't want to knock too much, but you know, that shows something. If you do that to an employer and if you really want to learn, and I think it says something, you know, and you don't get that a lot these days, a lot, you know. So of course he said yes. And I worked probably 2 or 3 months with him and he asked me to come on full time. We really hit it off. Something came natural to me. I loved it. I didn't mind being in the freezer, and it just felt really good.
What was that first experience like? I know you said you'd done a little bit of it during the buffet time, but when it actually comes to carving something in ice, what is that process like, and how did you initially work that process into something that would work for you? Was it Was it an art, or did you look at it as something else?
I think in the beginning it was completely art, and that was my passion for it and what I saw in it, on what you could do with this big block, normally single block, 300-pound block of ice. What could you turn that into that people are going to be oohing and aahing at?
300 pounds of ice. How large a block of ice are we talking?
It's our standard size. It's 40 inches tall, 20 inches wide, and 10 inches thick.
Okay, so water, everybody knows water is very dense. Mm-hmm. And I guess when it freezes, it gets more dense.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, that's a heavy... heavy piece.
It is. And that's just, if we're doing multi-block pieces, we can work with them like bricks.
Yeah.
So we could really, and what I learned in Boston and seeing and working with a full-time carver, you know, we did the first night in Boston every year, and he always did the biggest show. Mm-hmm. We built a Statue of Liberty out of 200 blocks of ice. So it was 60,000 pounds of ice that we were working with. And that was just
how close to scale is something like that?
Right. Well, we didn't do the whole body. It was more of a bust. So I would say it was pretty darn close.
Wow.
Pretty darn close. And it was massive. And that's the exciting. You could really do so much with it.
Yeah. So, I mean, you saw it as art right from the get-go.
I did.
And how did you take, because, I mean, you're going from the kitchen, which I still think of as an art form.
Totally.
But these are really sort of handsy blending of craft and art and kind of utilitarian tool sets. Mm-hmm. So going from the kitchen to carving, how much of that skill set did you have to learn as you went, and how much of it did you bring to the ice carving?
I think the passion came with me,
yeah,
and all of the desire, because working with the French food and stuff, it's like, you know, you're on your protein is always 6 o'clock and starch at 9 and veg at 12, you know, so plate presentation in French fine dining is you know, half the battle.
Yeah.
You know, of course you want it. It's got to taste fantastic and it's got to be cooked properly and all that. But the presentation that you're going to give to your guest, that first, it's art, like you said, you know, to see that plate and then to transfer it into the ice, you know, I'm staying in the same kind of field, hospitality and restaurants and all of that, but it's a whole different realm.
Yeah. What about as far as the tool set goes? Because I know in the kitchen you're using a lot of knives, you're using a lot of sharp blades of some kind with ice. What is the tool set like?
Yeah, I mean, I've gone from, you know, a potential burn or a slice with a knife to losing a limb. it's a lot of the tools. The chainsaw is our main tool, and you know, we all know how dangerous that is and could be. But we use a lot of angle grinder, which is like a sander, which is relatively safe. It's the die grinders. When you get into those, it's like a Dremel.
Yeah,
it's an oversized Dremel.
Okay.
Spins about 25,000 RPMs, and we use all these assorted bits on there, 5-inch bits. They have longer. I don't really go much longer than the 5-inch, but V bits and cone bits, and they are exceptionally dangerous.
Yeah. So what was the learning curve like? I mean, was there a point when you started carving in the ice where you looked at the stuff and go, I'm a little maybe hesitant to get too involved with this from a safety standpoint, almost?
Yeah, the tools, I mean, when I was taught by Steve, that was one of the major things, was safety.
Yeah.
You can instill it enough. Knock on wood, things have been very safe around here. But we take a lot of extra time for safety because we know, and I've seen, unfortunately, at competitions, and I've seen things go horribly wrong. And you always have to watch what you do. You always have to be attentive to things around you, people around you, and as long as you take that care, you're fine. If you have that safety feature built in, then the tools actually are really safe.
I know, like in the kitchen, the sharper the knife, the safer the knife.
Correct.
Because you have to put less pressure on the knife.
Correct.
Is that sort of a similar principle with ice carving?
Yeah, we use a lot of chisels.
Okay.
You know, all sorts of sizes, and we sharpen them in-house here. Mm-hmm. And when I'm done sharpening them, they are almost razor sharp.
Yeah.
They could cause, you know, some harm pretty quick.
So yeah, I'll bet.
It's, again, we're watching what you're doing and being very careful.
What is a workshop like for ice carving? I mean, we're recording now at a time of year where it's starting to get nice. People want to be mm-hmm. outside a little bit. The weather's starting to warm up. And ice doesn't survive much longer after this part of the year. So, I mean, obviously temperature control is a huge part of it. But what sort of conditions are you working in? And then how do you move this stuff?
Yeah, so my change in life is about a 100-degree office was the kitchen, you know.
Right,
you know, 90 degrees on the line when you're going. My current office is averages 12 to 15 degrees. It is chilly. It sounds really cold, but I can honestly say we're in full gear. Mm-hmm. We're in winter boots, ski gear, chili chokers, hats, and gloves.
Yeah,
proper gloves. And we're moving all the time, so you're not, you know, if you go outside and you're waiting at the bus stop or you're
right,
with your kids or whatever, you're standing there, you're freezing.
Sure.
Right, but we have a chainsaw in our hand pretty much all day long. We're moving these blocks of ice. We're shoveling snow and ice year round.
Yeah.
So I don't know. People have called me crazy, and they may still, but it's it's actually a very refreshing, crisp air. You know, like when you're outside on a really hot day and you're working, it's not very comfortable, right? You're sweating and you're doing things. But there's climate controlled, no humidity, and
I can deal with no humidity. All
exactly. In July, going in the freezer is actually really nice.
Yeah, right. I'll stick my head in the freezer a couple times on a day in July.
Yeah.
When you're transporting these pieces, I mean, any time of year, it's got to be challenging, especially for the larger pieces. What is that transport process like? Do you use a refrigerated vehicle?
It varies depending on the job. Large jobs, and we rent trucks and stuff like that when we're doing big jobs. Refrigerated trucks, but normally throughout the year, so we have a few freezers on site, but one of them is kept really cold, 0 to 10 below,
and that's cold.
Yeah, that's cold, but that's our storage freezer.
Okay.
So we're never really in there besides to get a carving, but. What we're doing by that is we're bringing the core temperature of the ice down really cold. And then we shrink wrap every sculpture. We wrap it in a thick insulated blanket and we shrink wrap it again. So basically what we have is a self-cooled sculpture that we transport. So even in July, I could have it in my car for 2 hours and it won't even start melting.
That's wild.
Yeah. And then in August and stuff, when it's really hot, really humid, I'll take some dry ice and we'll pack the trucks and we'll put dry ice over the sculptures and then insulate over the top of that, and it makes like a cooler.
How far are you able to move these things during the summer?
I would say we can pretty much go anywhere.
Really?
Wherever the client wants us to go. I mean, generally we stay in New England and New York and Pennsylvania and things like that, but larger jobs, you know, that we'd have to rent freezer trucks.
Yeah, but I mean, you could take it a 2-day trip or something if you had to, or?
Yep.
Really?
We also make, that's like a 2-inch foam board you would put on your house for insulation. That's a pink foam you get, at either of the big box stores. And we make coolers. So we make, 22 by 42 by 12 inch coolers that are 12 inches. And if we use those, we don't even have to shrink wrap the sculpture. We just put the ice in there, throw a little block of dry ice in there.
Yeah.
And I've gone on campouts before. I've gone to, I've sent them, like my wife went to a wedding in New Hampshire, but they had rehearsal dinner and they had this event before. But we shipped a carving up there, threw a block of dry ice in there, and the wedding was the next night. And
no problem.
No problem at all.
Wow.
As long as you're attentive, because you can't get it too cold. And obviously, you don't want it melting. So it's,
a
little bit of a fine line, but after you've done it a bit, you kind of get that.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That's wild to me that it's able to be transported that far. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we talked a little bit about the workshop space that you have, the temperatures and all that stuff. Tell me a little bit about the ice that you work with, because, I mean, I don't know a lot about ice. Mm-hmm. I've never carved even an ice cube in my life. But I mean, just by looking, I know that the ice looks different when it's on a pond as opposed to when it comes out of my freezer.
Sure.
So there's got to be different qualities of ice and different factors that contribute to where you can get the ice from. And I know as we were coming in here, you showed me the ice making freezers that you have. But what? Tell me a little bit about the ice. If you pull it out of a lake, if you go ice farming and you pull a block of ice out of the lake as opposed to what you can actually create in your own freezers.
Okay. Yeah. If you want to harvest ice off a lake, there's a lot of factors that really go into that. One is what kind of winter has it been?
Yeah.
And that you'll know just because you've gone through the winter. If it's warm, cold, snow, rain, freeze, and there's a lot of variation
in
winter.
That one sounds really familiar.
Exactly. I mean, it's really tough for us here in Connecticut. It's really hard to harvest good ice around here because you're going to have all of those layers. You could harvest ice and you could tell the actual date or anything, but you can see all the storms. You can see when it melted. You'll see lines, flat, perfect lines of layers, kind of like an archaeological dig,
right,
where they see all that those lines and stuff. You can really tell.
Yeah.
But if you want to harvest, even around here, we've been up to Norfolk, like I was saying, and you have to get movement. Movement in the water is key, and we'll get to to my ice, the commercial ice, in a second, and that's how we make it so nice. But if you have stagnant water, like an ice cube in your tray,
right
at home, you're making ice cubes, you take the ice cube out. It's nice and clear on the outside, but it's solid white in the middle.
Yeah.
It's trapped air bubbles. So that's all the white is air bubbles. And if you get the movement, so if you have a big pond, but it drains on one end, obviously you got to be very careful. That's where the ice is going to be the thinnest as well.
Sure.
You know, so please don't go running around down, you know, lakes by there. But any movement you have, that's where you're going to get the clarity of the ice.
And is it just because the air bubbles get moved out of the way?
Yeah, because it can't sit, right? So it's not stagnant. It's constantly moving. And as it's moving, it's freezing very slowly. And that's where you're going to get the clarity, the beautiful ice, the really clear cracks and bubbles and little things like that. As long as it's not overbearing, is fine. But when you get a lot of snow and then that melts down, if you're planning in the future, like, okay, this is my lake, I'm going to harvest ice here. As soon as it gets cold, you got to shovel.
Yeah.
You got to keep shoveling the snow and you got to keep the top clean.
Yeah, okay.
You know, because when it snows and melts, then you're going to build up those layers.
Right.
And it just won't be as nice. So there's a lot of stuff that when you're harvesting and trying to get good ice, a lot of factors go into it.
Yeah.
Now, with the business, because we're commercial and our clients have specific expectations and the quality of ice and the work and, you know, how the detail shows up, we, you know, all of our ice is made in-house that we use. We buy a lot holiday seasons and winter and stuff like that. But what we produce, commercial ice, is it's frozen from the bottom up.
Okay.
Kind of opposite of a lake as well. But it would be the same structure in the end. But so we freeze from the bottom up, and we constantly circulate the water on top. So the first day, when there's a lot of water in there, there's two pumps. So there's a lot of movement. And then the second and third day, there's one pump. Because the ice is coming up, it's freezing slower, so you don't need as much movement.
So it takes several days for one of these containers to actually create this block of ice.
For me to make one 300-pound block in the winter, it takes 3.5 days. In the summer, about 5 days.
Wow.
Of Connecticut electricity. If I could throw that in there.
Oh, yes, please.
As we all know, I mean.
I'll throw them right under the bus. I had to triple my bill this month, so that's fine.
Exactly. I mean, so you can imagine, I have 8 machines going that each have a half horse compressor on them.
Okay.
And then I have 3 freezers running 24/7.
All year,
and in the summer you can only
crank
imagine
that up a little bit.
It's tough. And
wow. So I mean, and you just mentioned a minute ago the the clarity of the ice affects the way the detail is visible.
Correct.
But you also, before that, said that when you're working on the ice, you're bundled up and you've got ski gear and these big gloves on. Now, detail work and big heavy gloves to me seem contradictory. So how how are you able to get all the fine detail done and still be able to maintain that safety and the warmth with the gloves?
The nice thing is that a lot of the tools that we use are big.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. So like the die grinder, which is probably our smallest tool. If you know a Dremel, it's probably 5 or 6 times as big as a Dremel.
Oh, wow. So that's a pretty hefty size machine.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's 2 hands on it.
Yeah.
At all times, unless you're brushing away snow and then the die grinder gets picked up over your head for safety. But, you know, it's all of the tools besides the chisels are 2-handed. So it's something you get accustomed to, I think.
Yeah.
You know, it feels almost more weird to have the tool in your hand without the gloves on after a long time, but you need them, and they're large enough that you don't never really, and you know, we don't use a Dremel.
Yeah.
We use tiny little things because everything is so big.
Right. So when you're talking about your clients are asking you to create certain pieces, what sort of events will you typically be asked to create an ice sculpture for? I imagine weddings have to be a big one.
Yeah.
What other kinds of things?
The neat thing about what kind of keeps our business interesting is that we have so many different seasons. We have things change. Like, so we'll start in January. January is all winter festivals, trying to get people out of the house. We do a lot of outside shows and carving in front of people and,
Like demonstration carving.
Exactly. Oh, okay. Yeah, large ones for, fire and ice festivals. You know, we have a few big ones. In January this year, we built an ice house in Hartford with 120 blocks of ice. we made a whole room, chairs and tables. And,
oh, wow.
So we're outside a lot, January, February. March is our rest month.
Okay.
So that's the 1 month that everybody gets a little downtime. Then we come up with new designs. We put the shop back together. We fix everything. Yeah. And then April is Easter.
Okay.
So then April comes, we're carving Easter eggs, bunnies, baskets, all sorts of bunnies. I mean, laying down bunnies, a bunny with a golf bag for the country clubs. You know, bunnies doing a lot of things, happy Easter logos. So it's Easter time.
Right.
And then after Easter, we roll right into Mother's Day.
Okay.
Which for us is a really big holiday because of all the buffets and all the, you know, the buffets that, you know, every country club has one. And all of our accounts, so we sell swans and hearts and, you know, we freeze flowers into the ice and make a lot of ornamental things and raw bars to hold shrimp.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
You know, all of that. And.
Do you do the sushi ice too?
Oh yeah, sushi towers and all sorts of
it. You are responsible for some of my favorite meals.
And that's a lot of July stuff. And then we have a lot of graduations.
Uh-huh.
We go into graduation season with all the colleges and high schools, and so we do a lot of shows with that.
A lot of the shot flumes.
Those are year round. Yep. Yeah, we're really close to Quinnipiac, and we're in a lot of handbooks at a lot of colleges.
I'll bet, yeah.
The luges are quite popular. And so end of May and June is our first wedding season. So you have all the early brides for springtime weddings.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very busy with that. And then we roll into July and August, and then it's all with country clubs, weddings. You kind of get a big combination in those months because all the clubs are really booming. Everybody's out and about. We do a lot of barbecues, a lot of outside stuff, because one of our most popular things are raw bars to hold your clams, oysters. And one of the things that we're doing a lot of, we started doing last year, more of this year, are shrimp towers.
Okay.
So we can pretty much incorporate into any sculpture. We've done golf bags. We do them for Easter. We do colored eggs. And so we hollow out the ice. You fill it with shrimp, and it dispenses out the bottom.
Wow.
So they become really popular, but right, shrimp, clams, oysters, you got to keep it cold.
Yeah.
And why not have it on a beautiful open clam shell out of ice?
Yeah.
And it serves its dual purpose, right? So it is really good. So after that, then we have September and October, which is all the fall weddings,
uh-huh.
right? Fall foliage, when I got married, and it's a really popular time, yeah. so we're really busy with weddings. And then November's Thanksgiving, and then all heck breaks loose. And then it's December, yeah. which...
office Christmas parties and all that stuff, probably.
I mean, I am thankful. Believe me, I am blessed, and the guys feel the same way. But basically, from 2 weeks before Thanksgiving, we're not off till Christmas. And we're working 14, 16-hour days,
yeah.
7 days a week, going through 100 blocks a week, and it's painful. It is... like you said, tons of office parties, a lot of Christmas tree lightings for town festivals.
Sure, yeah.
We are like compounds every weekend. I mean, we're doing a lot of outside shows.
Yeah.
It's a really tough time of year.
Well, it makes transportation easier.
Yeah, well, exactly. I mean, a lot of things are outside, and we were very blessed this year.
Yeah.
Sometimes we get a lot of snow in December, and but it's been getting less and less as the years progress. But this was probably the best December weather-wise that we've had in years.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there's been so remarkably little snow this year.
Yeah.
I'm just going to jinx it for everybody now.
So and
when everybody has a snow day tomorrow, you can thank me.
Exactly. Exactly.
So that's the commission side of it. That's the business side of it. And you said before that you always thought of this as an art more than anything else. So I want to talk about the art side of this for a couple minutes. Now, I was on your website, and I saw these amazing pictures of your time in Norway. So talk about that for a few minutes, because that's fascinating.
Yeah, that's where I get my artistic outlet. You know, you've been doing something for so long, and I'm still passionate about my business, passionate about what we do. But for me to get out and to get into the wild, as I call it, so many things, you have to troubleshoot, you have to play, you have to solve. Yeah, there's, and you're not in your space, right? Here it's controlled atmosphere.
Sure.
I have everything I need, and if I don't have it, I buy it. But, whatever we need to make the process happen here, we can get.
Right.
But to leave the confounds of here, home, and to go, that's where I get my satisfaction these days. And that's where, the instruments that you're saying, it's been doing it for the last 12 years in a town called Yarlo, Norway, and we harvest all the ice out of lakes.
This is called ice music, right?
It is ice music. So okay. What I do is throughout the year, I collaborate with musicians, and I might add that these are world-famous musicians that I'm working with who have taken the chance to get out of their comfort zone and try their instrument on ice. So I collaborate with them. I learn structure. I learned poundage on strings if it's a string instrument.
Oh, sure. I saw a cello.
Cellos, harps, guitars, violins, a lot of Norwegian
that's
instruments.
That's got to be wildly complicated. You'll get the tension correct.
It is. The harp especially. The harp, there's about 2 tons of pressure on a harp. And ice can only take so much. Where ice is incredibly strong, that you can... It's trial and error sometimes. Like the first guitar I made, it took me 12 hours. If you ask me to make one now, I could probably do it in a few hours, depending if I had all the parts, because we obviously have to cheat with the strings, and I have to use the head of the guitar so the musician can tune it.
Oh,
because
we
can't.
You can't make ice tuning pegs?
I can make them, but you can't, they'll freeze. Right, I can't get the resistance.
Sure.
I'm not a musician myself, but I've been doing it for so long, and I've worked with so many musicians that I've learned the instruments.
Yeah.
I know the ins and outs. I mean, even making a violin, I met a master violin maker in Wallingford.
Ice violin?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Several times. And
that's one of the most delicate and intricate instruments.
Yeah.
To be able to make one out of ice is pretty impressive.
Exactly. And to push it and to see, like... The first time almost any sculpture is thick. It's solid. You're safe. Uh-huh. Like when I was back in Newport, all my sculptures were thick, big, blocky. But as you learn the medium and you learn what you're working with, you can bring it down fragile. You can really make it smaller. And I've broken violins before because I've pushed it too far.
Yeah.
I've tried to make the bottom too thin, the whole case of it. Really thin. Because I was challenged once to actually try to get the violin to resonate, to vibrate.
Through the ice.
And,
wow.
And there's only certain ways that you could do that. It's got to be very cold. It's got to be very thin. So you're really chancing a lot of things.
Yeah.
And I've had one break on a musician before. But then you know, okay, I can't go that far.
Right.
You know, you learn. So that, to be asked to go out there and the process of the collaboration with the musician, the process of harvesting ice and working with the people I work there that do a lot of the harvesting. I mean, I'll go and do some, you know, fluff harvesting, you know. But, I mean, we get, you know, 2,000-pound blocks of ice, and they're harvesting.
A single block?
Yeah. Yeah. But that's harvested with tractors and
I hope so.
Massive chainsaws. And, you know, so I'm not around for that part. You know, a lot of the times, like they do in Sweden for the ice hotel, they're harvesting right now. You could see it on Facebook.
Yeah.
They're harvesting the ice for next year's ice hotel.
Yeah.
You know, so it's always done a year ahead. So that process and being in the elements, and we're outside, you know, all the time. We build the whole amphitheater out of snow with excavators.
Wow.
And snow cats. And, you know, so you're in the elements. You're in the wild, right?
Yeah.
It began the first few years we were doing it. We're on top of a mountain in the middle of nowhere. You can just imagine the serenity and how peaceful it was.
Yeah.
And that's a good out. You know,
it's really a fascinating kind of juxtaposition of elements there, because snow is sort of a sound dampening element, like fluffy snow. Everybody knows you're standing outside during a snowfall and it just, there's no noise. Mm. You know, that there's that silence that you don't really get anywhere else. But at the same time, ice is such a reverberant thing. Like the sounds will bounce off of that all day long. Mm. And now you're up in the mountains making musical instruments in these amazing settings. I can only imagine like the inspiration that must provide,
right,
to not just you as the ice sculptor, but for the musicians and everybody else involved. It's got to,
right,
be incredible.
It's a lot of what we call is the experience.
Yeah.
You know, life's experiences and to be there. And ice has so many factors, like you're saying, that even in a concert, the ice temperature.
Yeah.
It's huge for us. If you came to, on Saturday, we would do an afternoon concert for kids and what have you, and families, and it could be around zero or Celsius. It could be around 32,
mm-hmm.
You know, so you're right on that cusp, and if ice gets warm, it gets soft,
mm-hmm.
And it absorbs vibration.
Right.
You know, so it's a dull, kind of boring sound. There's not any ring to it. But at night, if you come back for the 10 o'clock concert or the midnight concert on,
yeah,
Saturday night, when it's, you know, 10 below or 20 below, it's cold for the concert. But,
sure.
But the ice just sings. I mean, it vibrates. And I made a marimba we call it the isophone.
Okay.
But a xylophone.
Yeah.
For four gentlemen to play. Had 60 bars on it, fully in tune.
Really?
So they all had their tuning to their part of the song, and like to come back to during the day, it's kind of a dung, 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 dung.
Right.
But at night, it's bing, bing. I mean, it just vibrates, yeah, and it's amazing. So we say every concert is different. Even if you came to the 10 o'clock and the midnight one,
sure,
it's only 2 hours apart, but if the temperature drops 5 degrees, every instrument's going to sound different.
Yeah. Wow.
Something I had done, unfortunately, haven't done in a long time, is competing. That was when I first opened the business, and until about, boy, it's so long now, but until about 2007, about 8 years, I was very competitive, and I would travel the country and the world competing. And to do that, not only can you push the ice so much further, you're challenged to push the ice. So you're making the most complex, risky carving that you could make because you want to win, right? So it's, you can get out there and you, every piece you do is nothing like you. You can't really sell a competition piece. There's some on the website, like the 12 and a half foot tall praying mantis. Super fragile, about 45 individual pieces carved separately, refrozen back together on site. I did a 12 foot tall Cat in the Hat. If you've read the Cat in the Hat, Dr. Seuss book, it's one that he's balancing on a ball with one leg.
And
he's got, it was the year I won the national championships in 2004. That 2004 was probably my, not the end, but it was my biggest competitive, my most successful year. Competing, and it was everything. He had the fishbowl, the plate, the cake on his head, the, the hat, and the plate or the platter resting on his foot, and it was so complex.
Yeah, it's a picture right off the cover of the book, right?
Exactly. Yeah. You know, and that was a time when my kids were little, and I was reading the Cat in the Hat, and thankfully, because come up with the piece is the most, is the hardest part.
So tell me a little bit about the competition. How does that work? I mean, do you go in with a theme that you have to work toward, or do they actually give you, you know, make this?
Yeah, it depends on the festival that's having it. Sometimes they're themed because they're, you know, like when Frozen came out, it was very big.
Right.
Obviously, everybody knows it. And
yeah, get ready for wave two.
Exactly. Olaf, here he comes again. But the, you know, if they're having a Frozen theme and Elsa's there, and so that they want you to carve in theme.
Sure.
They want more monuments or what have you, sculptures around to stay in theme. And then they have some that they'll just say, like up in Stowe last year was, which I haven't been to in 5 years, but it was out of this world.
Okay.
So, but you can take that. You could do aliens. You could do spaceships. You could do anything relative to that
theme. So that was more of a wide open interpretation kind of
exactly
thing.
Okay. And you could really play on that, you know. It's, and it's just one small part of the criteria for judging anyway. So
sure.
Even if you went off theme, you would have to put up a, you know, pretty substantial piece. But you know, it's good to stay in theme.
How does the judging usually work? Is it just like the technical achievement? Is it creative vision? Like, how do they go about all that
stuff? All those. They have a pretty good, it's usually like a 10-point or 10-category system. Mm-hmm. Like you said, first impression.
Okay.
Utilization of ice.
Okay.
Which is really important because you don't want to have tons of scrap ice. You know, why not use it and make your sculpture better? Complexity or how fragile is it? You know, how far did you push the ice?
Mm.
And theme, if there's a theme. Structure, originality. So it's pretty complex. When you really get into it, it depends. You know, if you're competing on like NICA, which is a National Ice Carving Association.
Okay.
So if you're competing on their circuit, they're really strict. You know, if you're doing anatomy, they'll measure from wrist to elbow.
Oh, really?
And then they'll measure the other one, you know, and you'll lose
proportion.
Exactly. So proportion is a big one, you know, depending. And so people who go with anatomy are really taking a risk.
Do they take that into account? I mean, they say you really tried to achieve something even if you didn't.
Yeah, so they won't dock you
a
lot. You know, they'll hit you in other categories. You know, they'll make you pay for it if you're off, as they should. You know, because if you're trying to do a person, then it's got to be a person, right?
Right.
We all know what a person looks like, and so you can't, there's no room for error, but. Right. If you go with the Cat in the Hat,
sure,
right? It's a cartist, you know, cartoon. It's there's room. They can't measure anything,
right?
So you have to kind of weigh that stuff. And I love structure was my thing. I loved stability. I love to push ice as far as you could push it.
Yeah,
I would rather my piece crash, fall down, smash in a million pieces, than not win when I was competing. So, you know, I've had sculptures, you know. They're always timed. If it's a one block, it's 2 hours.
Okay.
And if it's two block, it's four hours. It's speed, you're definitely, especially if you're pushing it.
Yeah.
You know, I had done also, my boys were young and was watching a lot of cartoons and the Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote. And
yeah.
I had done.
Well, if it crashes, then you just say, well, that's what the cartoon was going
to
do.
Exactly. It was meant to happen, yeah. You know? I mean, I had that piece that year. It was for the Nationals, and I had done this big tree with a branch coming out, Wildy Coyote underneath it with a chainsaw, sawing the branch with a roadrunner on top of it. But as Wildy Coyote would do, the branch was looked like in the artistic ice way, it was crashing and it was going to fall on him.
Sure.
Right. And the roadrunner's on top. And I was literally on a ladder about, you know, I don't know, 10, 12 feet up. And I'm putting the little wing on the roadrunner. This was probably, again, 30, 40 pieces. Who knows how many pieces I had. I'm up there. I'm putting this wing on, just trying to freeze it on. And the whole piece just collapses. And I am at the Nationals, the most prestigious competition of the year. I'm standing on a ladder, right? I'm the worst, in front of crowds of people. And I'm standing there with this, like, you know, 16-inch, you know, 10-inch wing. Uh-huh. And that's the only thing left of my piece, you know. There's actually a picture. You can see it on the wall.
That's massive.
The first Nationals of my piece is crashing, but it made the front page of the paper, and you know,
that's wild.
You win some, you lose some, but to push it, like in life, you know, you push it and enjoy it and risk reward.
How many people you generally compete in the competitions?
In the Nationals, the years that I was going, there's probably 30.
Okay, it's pretty big field,
pretty substantial field at the Nationals, because that's the big one. Everybody.
Yeah. And, I mean, this whole thing, everything we're talking about, going all the way back to your time in the kitchen, everything that you've been working in is temporary. Mm, the food is cooked. It's eaten.
Yeah.
The water's frozen. It's carved, and it melts again.
Right.
What is it about such a temporary show of this great skill that you've spent so many years working on? Why are you drawn to that temporary nature of the creativity?
I think it comes back to, I love experiences.
Yeah.
And I love to give experiences. So you eat that plate of food, it's a memory. Not only is it a visual aspect, the culinary aspect of it, your palate part of it.
Yeah.
Your sitting there, and it's not like you're going to a McDonald's. You're in and out, you're gone, you're back on the road, you're working again.
Right.
You eat, and you eat a meal like this, 5-course, 6-course, 7-course meal, it's an experience. You will always remember that.
Right.
And then with the ice, if you go to a wedding, not knocking weddings, or any big function like that, it's a function. You go there, yeah. You know, hobnob, to do all that. But if you walk in there, and there's a showcased beautiful ice sculpture on the table around beautiful food.
Right.
You're going to take pictures with it. You're going to remember
That's
it.
That's true, yeah.
We've been blessed, and we've gotten many, many thank yous. And not only did the carving meet their expectations, but beat the food, beat the venue. And that is what everybody spoke about. So it's providing this moment of joy, a temporary moment of joy.
Yeah.
That I'm trying to achieve. I want you to go, wow, I want you to remember it, and I want it to go.
Yeah.
You know, it's that memory. It's that, of course, we take pictures. You can see them on the website, and everything is categorized, and, you know, but it's that impermanence. I don't know if that's a word, but it's, you know, we like to say it's a temporary art that leaves a lasting impression. So you'll always remember that, I hope. It's my desire. My goal is to make you remember that. But
I always know when I get my sashimi plate and it's on an ice tower, I take that picture.
Right, exactly, exactly.
I don't usually photograph my food, but I'm taking a picture my sashimi.
We make plates with bride and groom's name on them or company logos, and they eat their salad, and they're done with their salad, and bam, their logo's in an ice plate or sorbet dishes for an intermezzo, you know, in between courses on a nice meal, and you get that piece of ice, and it just it's a statement, you know.
Yeah.
It says something. So there's something about that, and when I come back to the experience, it's my transfer from cooking to ice was easy because of the experiences.
Yeah.
Because when I was cooking, if I wanted to commit somewhere and be somewhere for a certain amount of time, I would go find a job. Mm-hmm. But now the ice, I mean, Greenland, north of Canada, Greenland, Iceland, Norway, Sweden, Finland, Italian Alps. I've done ice music at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C.
Really?
Oh, wow. You know, so the places it's brought me and the experiences that I've been able to get and will continue. I mean, I may be off to, you know, almost the North Pole at the end of April. And, you know, so when I could get out and go to an adventure, an experience in life, that's
amazing.
That's the best gift I could get.
I'd imagine. So among all the sculptures that you've done, whether for yourself or for whatever the next corporate event is going to be, do you get one request more than others? Like, is there something that you've done so many times now, you could almost do it blindfolded? Not that I'm suggesting you use a chainsaw blindfolded.
Not very safe.
Right.
I would say that is very seasonal. You know, like, I can't tell you how many bunnies I've carved. And when we get into weddings, swans, and, you know, swan is very important. Yeah. I mean, swans, they mate for life. It's very relative to weddings. And we make a beautiful swan. We make kissing swans, and their hearts form a neck. And
sure.
Could I carve a swan blindfolded? Almost. You know? I mean, I could see every motion in my head. And I could probably carve a swan and make somebody's head spin. I could do it so fast. And clamshells, open clamshell in the summer is extremely popular.
Okay.
Reindeers, you know, Rudolph.
All right.
I don't know how many of those we do.
Where do you get the red ice?
We use a red LED.
Oh, well, there you go.
And it's the
secrets of the trade.
And it's the showstopper at every demonstration when we drop that red LED in there. Olaf, like we were speaking about Frozen before, but for the carrot, we do an orange LED, so his nose is actually orange.
Nice.
You know? So we bring a lot of that into it. So every season has its. I've been doing it for 22 years, so there's. Every season has its very repetitive carving.
Yeah.
And, but, I mean, they're all beautiful, and they're not to be knocked. But, you know, my joy and a satisfaction, I guess, when a customer calls me and they're like, I'm getting married next month. My wife, Jen, runs the office, and she'll get the call, and we're getting married next month at so-and-so. And one of her first questions is, well, what do you do?
Yeah. Okay.
Where did you guys meet?
Yeah.
What's relative and what's personal to you? Because I could get the most satisfaction is carving something for you, 100% original, and very meaning. For instance, we had two officers who were getting married, and we carved. They both worked at the same
precinct.
Precinct. Or, yeah. Okay. So we carved their badge. We had two guns.
Okay.
We had their names on top, their married name on the bottom, you know, their last name on the bottom. So it's extremely personal, you know. Or, I got engaged at the Eiffel Tower, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, would you like us to carve the Eiffel Tower for your wedding, you know. So things that happen that are very personal to the client brings me joy.
Yeah. Like,
Sikorsky came out with a new troop carrier helicopter. Mm-hmm. We carved the helicopter for them.
Wow.
You know, so those special things, those challenges, you know, although if we had them every day, it becomes very challenging because a lot more time is spent on those than, you know, one of the pieces that's on our website.
Yeah. Is there one specific piece that somebody has asked you to do over the years? That when you initially heard it, you're like, I don't know how I'm going to pull this off. Or something that was just so unique that you had it, you know, one time and haven't really seen anything like it since. Something that was particularly challenging to you.
Anatomy and movement is always very challenging.
Oh, yeah.
Golf tournaments, we do a full golfer in full swing, or a boy is having his bar mitzvah and he's a baseball player. I've carved a catcher, you know,
okay.
He's a catcher and his name and number were on the back. You know, so when you get into like people's faces, we had one gentleman for his wedding wanted me to carve his head, but out of three blocks, 40 inches tall, 20 inches wide, 30 inches, so about the proportions of a proper head.
Okay.
Completely hollow the thing out, fill it with 100 pounds of shrimp, his mouth wide open, and people taking shrimp out of his mouth. That one's on the website. You can see him and his ice face. And so when you're trying to match people's faces, it's very touchy, right? I mean, you don't want to go wrong.
Right.
You don't want to.
I don't look like that.
Exactly. Exactly. So I would say anatomy is tough.
Yeah.
Those are usually the most challenging. Or helicopters, you know, with props or propellers on them. You know, when you get into really fragile sculptures, then it... You know, how thick can I make it to last the function? We got to find out how long the function is. And there's a lot of elements that go into how far I can push it.
Yeah.
Generally for a banquet, for a wedding, and we have to keep the ice relatively thick. It's got to last the function. It's got to be safe. And a lot of factors come into it, so we can't push.
Well, it's going to be out of the cooler or whatever for 8 to 10 hours probably. Right.
Yeah. You know, a good standpoint there is ice melts about a quarter inch an hour, eighth inch per side proportionally in a controlled banquet room. Key factor.
Oh, interesting.
Right? In a controlled wedding or banquet facility.
That is the end of the math for this episode.
Though. Exactly.
there's a cutoff for math.
Yep. There's you know, a lot of outside factors and wind and kind of things like that. It's all things.
You have to factor that into everything, especially outdoors, I would guess. Right.
Yeah. We don't give any guarantees for the outside.
Of course not.
We try our best. We've had clients put fans on them trying to cool them off before outside. And
that just evaporate the melt off faster?
It's actually the exact worst thing they could have done. And we've actually had one of our only complaints in a long time of owning the business. They sent us a picture after they put the fan on it and complained about the carving. And we were very nice and, you know, and talked to them about it. And first of all, it was outside. It was in a warehouse building on the top floor. It was already 100 degrees up there.
Oh,
and,
my God.
And then, you know. So, I mean, there's factors, you know.
Yeah.
You have to play into. But generally, any sculpture we do lasts the entire function. And if it's for cocktail hour, then we can make them more fragile. We can kind of push the ice a little bit, which is more fun for me, too.
Okay, so... Before I release people back out into the world to go about whatever it is you're doing before this, I always like to get a recommendation from everybody for something maybe that you've experienced recently that you would encourage other people to try.
I've turned off the TV.
Okay.
I've turned off Facebook.
Okay.
I've stopped things interfering with my life. I've looked for only good news. I've looked for good things. I'm trying to find peace in this very tough times that we live in. I think everybody can relate to that. Back when I was growing up, we didn't even have cell phones, right?
So right.
Didn't have all of these distractions that we have in life, and I'm trying to let go of those. And if I can push anything on anybody, it's to get back to nature, get back to your family,
sure.
Shut off the distractions. It's hard, and I still look at...
You are not the first person to make that recommendation.
Yeah, okay.
You will not be the last person to make that recommendation. That is something I try to do myself. I'm terrible at it.
Right.
But I try.
In this world that we live in,
it's really hard.
And if you don't watch it, see it, or like it on Facebook, somebody's going to tell you about it.
Right.
And you're going to get sucked into it.
If you didn't see it on Facebook, did it ever really happen?
Right. That's exactly true. And I've seen a lot of negativity in this. You know, we have to come back to finding positiveness and happiness and be good to one another.
Yeah.
You know, and that's, we see so much negative. How can we not think negative? The only way to cut that out is to shut off the news, care about what's in your community, and go explore around you.
Yes.
Everybody wants to go so far away, and they have to go and see all this. And would you ask me 10 fun things to do in Connecticut? I grew up here. Mm-hmm. I left for 8 or 10 years, but I came back. I don't know half there probably is to know in Connecticut.
It's but, really, once you get looking, it's amazing how much there all right. is to do here.
Go out, get on your bike. I mean, I went bike riding for the first time in years with my family last weekend on the bike trail.
Nice.
And we rode for 12 miles. I'm like, this is beautiful.
That's awesome.
You know, get out, shut it off.
Well, I mean, that's what this is. This whole podcast is all about, experiencing new things and,
yeah.
and you know, getting that word out that there's other stuff out there to try.
And what a fantastic opportunity you have to.
I love this. Yeah. Like, I know now about ice sculpting.
Yep, exactly.
I knew nothing about this an hour ago, and now I get to learn.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for doing you. This. This is amazing.
I really appreciate you coming.
I think that's it.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah. I think we've covered it. And
yeah.
So now let's go in the freezer and carve some ice.
Yeah, right. Okay. Thank you again to Bill Covitz for coming on the show. Really fascinating stuff. If you're looking for some ice art for an event of your own, make sure to check out icematters.com. And even if you aren't looking for a carving, just go take a look at those ice music photos. They're incredible. So if you're enjoying the show, I hope you'll consider leaving a rating and a review on Apple Podcasts or on Podbean or wherever you listen. Every review helps others find the show. And if I read your review on the show, I'll send you a Table to Stage sticker pack as a thank you. So rate, review, subscribe, and help spread the word. We are also coming close to the first Table to Stage live on May 22nd. Comedian Rob Santos, singer-songwriter Abby Auden, and drag queen sensation Summer Orlando and Barbara Jones Streetsand will all be performing at CT Comedy Theater in Hartford, and the tickets are just $15. Tickets can be purchased online exclusively at tabletostagepod.com/live. I hope to see many of you there. That is it for now. Until next time, keep creating.